الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم.
Those ulama that sacrificed their life, their blood, they are the ones that protected this religion for us. And that's how the religion came to us. And today, we calling ourselves to love ilm are mocking that ilm. Because we sell it for money. Then Imam Ahmad, when the government, when the Khilafah, the Abbasiyya became corrupted in their Aqidah, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he would be walking and he was older, and at this time he was of an elderly age, and he would have his ink pot and his shoes, and this would be like the beginning students. They would be, you know, going between the different durus and halaqat and lessons, and they would have their ink pots, and sometimes they would have their shoes in their hands. They would be rushing back and forth. So he would be rushing in the same way. Some people would tell him, Imam, you are an Imam now. You're Imam. His son, for example, Abdullah, he says, I told my father, you are the Imam of the Ahl Sunnah today. And this is after the hardship that he had gone through. He said, today you are the Imam of the Ahl Sunnah. Why are you walking around like the beginning students? He said, we take our ink pots from our cradles to our graves. Till the grave, this is our way. We continue to say. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, how many hadith did he memorize?
No? 1 million.
Half. 1 million ahadith. Alf? Alf hadith. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, he was in a halaqah once. And he said, Qala Ahmad. Said Imam, yani Ahmad said, he was giving the opinion of the ulama. One man in the halaqah, and some people, they don't have enough adab, unfortunately. In the halaqah, he speaks, but he goes, Ya Shaykh, but Ahmad huwa rajul, wa ana rajul, عنده قول لقول. يعني, Imam Ahmad, he's a man, and I'm a man. He has a statement, and I have a statement. Shaykh bin Uthaymeen told him, Hafala Ahmad alf hadith. يعني, Imam Ahmad memorized 1,000,000, 1,000,000 hadith. كم حفظت يا أخي? How many did you memorize? Now go ahead. And see the man just get quiet. Okay. But how? Who paid his scholarship? Who funded him? Who gave him that ability? Imam Ahmad, he never took money for seeking knowledge or for teaching knowledge. He would stitch the silwar, you know, the pants? It's a lowly thing, stitching silwar. He would stitch the silwar and sew and fix and take that money and learn. Yahya bin Ma'in, Imam Ahmad, as Ibn Jawzi has mentioned his manaqib, they were going for Hajj. Imam Ahmad told Yahya bin Ma'in that when we go for Hajj, after Hajj, I want to go to Yemen, Sana'a. Because there is a great scholar of Hadith, Abdul Razak, Sana'a. So I want to take Hadith from this great scholar. So after Hajj, let's go to Yemen. Yahya bin Ma'in told him, we don't have money. Tell him Allah will make a way. When he got to Mecca, they ran out of money. Their funds, their provisions finished. Money, I don't mean like additional money. Money meaning like food and what they needed to travel and things like this. Yahya bin Ma'in told Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, we finished, how can we go? Allah will make a way. Yahya bin Ma'in finds out that Abdul Razak al-San'ani from Sana'a, from Yemen, was there in the same Hajj. Allahu Akbar. Yahya bin Ma'in, he became so happy, he went to Imam Ahmad, he said, Allah has answered your dua. He said, what? He said, the Razak is here, in Mecca, you can go and take the hadith from him here. Imam Ahmad said, no. He said, that's not the way of the people of Tullab ilm, the people of knowledge. The knowledge should not come to you, you should go to the knowledge. If the Razak came here, this is not the place. I will meet with him, I will make the tawaf with him, but I will still travel to Sana'a, to Yemen, to take knowledge from him, because that is the etiquette of knowledge that I have to sacrifice to go and get knowledge. Today everybody wants knowledge in their living room, in their bedroom, while they're sitting with their feet up, drinking hot cocoa. And then they wonder, how come I don't memorize a million hadith? Imam Ahmad, he met Abdul Razzaq. He made Tawaf, he made the Hajj. Afterwards, he wanted to go to now Yemen. Abdul Razzaq went back, he wanted to go to Yemen. But he ran out of funds. He has no funds. This is not a fairy tale. It's not like, you know, just gold's going to drop from the sky. Allah is qadir on everything. But there is a sabab. There is a hikmah in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained. Imam Ahmad now is on his way. He doesn't have even food. So he sells himself into indentured servitude. What does that mean? It's a temporary slavery, where you have to fulfill a certain amount of work, and then you're free. Until then, you're a slave. And they give you a certain amount of money. So he sold himself, imagine, for knowledge. So he's taking care of camels, and he's doing all of this thing. And people are telling him, what's wrong with you? Borrow money from somebody, it's okay. And then you can spend that time, instead of farming, instead of sitting there and working, you could spend that time memorizing hadith. Imam Ahmad said no. And that's what I'm telling, the barakah is there. Many of those ulama at that time that worked for the sultan, for the kings, and made money, had more time on their hands, but which one of them memorized a million hadith? So Imam Ahmad now, he's in this trip, and he's out there, and he has sold himself. And now that caravan is coming close to Yemen. Abdul Razzaq, the great scholar of hadith, he hears about this. And he heard about Imam Ahmad, and he knew about Imam Ahmad, and he had met Imam Ahmad, so he knew that he was a great person. So Abdul Razzaq, he goes out, and he says, I had 10 dinar. Abdul Razzaq, when he mentioned this, he was crying. Later when he was telling people what happened, he was crying. He said, I had 10 dinar, gold dinar. So I went to Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He said, you are a blessed man, a great scholar. What are you doing? You're doing this hard labor work. Here's 10 dinar. I'll give it to you. You pay off your servitude and come and learn. Imam Ahmad told Abdul Razzaq, Ya Abu Bakr, or Abu, يعني, Kunya Abu Bakr, if I was to take money from anyone, I would have taken it from you. But no. Principle. That is why, my brothers, those were the ulama. Abdullah, the son of Imam Ahmad, he said, my father used to regularly read 1/7 of the Quran every day. Wallahi, sometimes when we read this, the shame comes upon us. Not in Ramadan, not occasionally, every day 1/7 of the Quran. Abdullah ibn Ahmad, he said, my father, when he was in prison, he used to make 300 nafal rak'at in a day, at night. Nafal. Not including the fara'id. But this is the time when he was in prison. My respected brothers, sisters, Allah alim and ulama, few kings in history have protected the religion. Not saying there are not. There were, and inshallah there will be. But if you look at tariq, if you look at the umara, muluk, you will find few that protected the religion. And you will find most were just concerned about their kingdom, their wealth, their enjoyment. Illa mashallah, except to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who protected this religion for us? It was those that inherited the inheritance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This religion was protected for us by the ulama, by those fuqara, those broke, poor, masakeen, who weren't worried about what people thought, who weren't worried about If I sit with this person, people will call me off the manhaj. If I dress this way, people will judge me this way. If I say this, then people will not like me. I will not get an invite to the White House. I will not be invited to come. No, those ulama that sacrificed their life, their blood, they are the ones that protected this religion for us. And that's how the religion came to us. And today, we, calling ourselves to love and are mocking that ilm. Because we sell it for money. Then Imam Ahmad, when the government, when the Khilafah, the Abbasiyah became corrupted in their Aqidah, they started to say the Quran is makhluq. When this came as the government line, the official line of the Khilafah, not talking about a president or a king, a Khalifa, and he is ba'a. But he corrupted the Aqidah. He said the Quran is makhluq. Most people today will be like, what's the big deal? Okay, he's still Muslim, he still says the name of Allah, he still believes in the Quran, he believes in the Prophet ﷺ, he still makes salah, he's still fighting jihad, he's still doing all of that, he's making salah amongst the people, so what's the big deal? La! If the Quran was makhluq, if the Quran was creation, then it could be wrong. Every makhluq has shortcomings, but the Quran is not makhluq, it is kalamullah, it is the words of Allah, the Khaliq. And anything from the Khaliq is غير مخلوق. So it is perfect. There is no contradiction, there is no mistake, there is no chance of anything being wrong. Because as the Khaliq is perfect, his kalam is perfect. So when the Mu'tazila, they brought this Aqidah, and the kings, with their swords, with their spears, with their arrows, with their armies, with their authority, with their wealth, with everything, brought this down. How many ulama sold their religion? How many ulama took the rukhsa and they just lied to protect their lives? How many ulama fled? But there were two who stood. Muhammad bin Nuh and Ahmad ibn Hanbal. They didn't have an army. They didn't do a revolution. They didn't go and protest. They didn't go and lobby. They stood. Muhammad bin Nuh died early. Naturally, he died. So the whole Khilafah right now, Abbasiyah, with all their strength, is pushing an Aqidah, and there is one man standing. One man standing. That man is Ahmad ibn Hanbal. They offer him money, they offer him status. No, not going to sell out. This is a nasiha to our imam. I'm not a leader in the Muslim community, I'm just a low servant. But those that are in leadership, those that are respected, those that are in these big groups and folk, look at the salaf of the sunnah and look at what you're doing. Imam Ahmad, he stood firm. That Imam, against everybody, the whole world, it was against him in that sense. Except for the Mukhlisin, they were quiet. They were with him, but they were quiet. They took him for trial. They imprisoned him. Talk about knowledge. These are the people of knowledge. They imprisoned him. He said, I'm not worried about being imprisoned because the prison cell and my house is the same. The Salaf. Zuhud. He said, I'm not worried about being killed. Because I know if I'm killed, I'm a shaheed. He said, but I don't want to be whipped. I mean, I don't want the fitna of the whip. Because the whip, we're not talking about like somebody going, hey, hey. I mean, the whip, when they would hit, it would rip the skin. And the whip, when they would hit, they would whip your face. He said, I'm worried about the fitna of the whip. Until he saw the criminal, who told him something. He said, "Oh, Ahmad, you are on the haq. I have been whipped for drinking alcohol and other sins, and I have been patient for my sin. Don't sell out for the haq." Imam Ahmad said, "Nobody's words gave me more comfort than this." He said, "After that, I was not worried about the whip. I'm on the haq. Whatever happens, happens." So now that Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he's brought in front of the Khalifa. How many excuses can you make? He's the Khalifa. He's this, he's that. People are there. His opponent is also named Ahmad, maybe Dawah. He's there, Mu'tazili. And they want to debate with him. And he's kept in a prison cell. He's fasting in the day, they don't give him food at night. He has to carry chains. After all of that, hungry, tired, imprisoned, under pressure, under stress, they bring a panel of the Mu'tazila. And they're debating. And everything they do, he responds with the Quran, he responds with Hadith, he quietens them. And every time they're like, "What about Al-Kalam? What about this?" He doesn't say, "I'm going to use it to debate." No, he says, "Give me something in the Quran or the Hadith, I will respond." He shuts them up. So when the people, they cannot debate with you, what do? They want to go to violence. You bring the whip. Subhanallah, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, the great scholar, hadith scholar of Hadith, scholar of fiqh, such an honored personality. What is he being whipped for? Imagine when you're in front of Allah and Imam Ahmad is there and Imam Ahmad is asked, "Oh Ahmad, what were you whipped for?" But he stood firm on the aqidah of Islam. And me and you, we want to sell out for what? That Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he was whipped. Even on the face, his face ripped open. It's not a Disney story. His face was ripped open. They had to take metal claws and pull the skin and solder it. And when he was being whipped, his izar, his loincloth, started to loosen. Check the Kutub al-Tariq that were checked. His loincloth started to loosen. He made dua. He didn't make dua, "Oh Allah, get me out of it." No, he made dua, "Oh Allah, don't let my aura be exposed." Two hands came out of the ground. This is not some story tale. Two hands came from the ground, held his izar. The nusra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go look in Zahabi, look at Kutub al-Tariq, go look it up. Imagine when he's asked in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Ahmad, what were you whipped for?" And we are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will question us. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those that will at least respect knowledge enough not to sell out our religion, not to sell out our stance, not to sell out our aqidah, not to sell out our fiqh, not to sell out the Quran and Sunnah, not to sell out the way of the Salaf of the Ummah. At least stand on what is haq. And if you cannot, be quiet. If you cannot, stay quiet. But don't go and say that which is khalif. Because you know, in the end, you will go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who practice on what we say and those that can benefit from what we've heard. جزاك الله خيرا.